about you?
All right.
Are you on those?
Yes.
You are. That's what I thought. There's some neighbors here that want us to continue it, which I think probably we ought to do, but unless there's some compelling reason. Is the developer here?
Yeah. Jared Eden is, Anna Bressy is the actual applicant on it, but she's with Jared Eden's.
Okay, great.
He's
great.
Around here somewhere.
Okay, I saw Jared. Thank you.
Yep.
Good evening, everyone.
Good evening.
Good evening, everyone.
Good evening.
Yeah, I'm speaking to everyone. And welcome to our City Council session of January 17th, 2017. At this time, we will have a moment of silent meditation. I will certainly ask that you reflect on this past weekend and those values or virtues that you've taken from the activities that you attended. Thank you. Mr. Davis, would you please lead us in the pledge of allegiance?
Of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you, sir. Madam Clerk, would you call the roll?
Yes. Mayor Bill has an excused absence. Mayor Pro Tem Cole McFadden.
Present.
Councilmember Davis. Councilmember Johnson. Councilmember Moffitt. Councilmember Reese and Councilmember Shule.
One ceremonial item tonight, and it is the neighborhood spotlight. So if Mr. James Clark could join me. If his village is with him tonight, would you please join him? Who is the neighborhood
folk? Oh, there she is right there.
Let me just share a little bit about the program. The purpose of the program is to recognize residents who have gone above and beyond the call of duty to improve our communities. And so this is a resident who we're grateful to have in Durham, and we will present to you a certificate, and let me just, and it reads, James Clark is the recipient of the Neighborhood Spotlight for the month of January 2017. The Neighborhood Spotlight Award recognizes community members that have gone above and beyond in volunteering their time to serve the community. This month, James Clark, I've said your name several times now, A resident of Autumn Woods of Woodcroft neighborhood was nominated and selected because of the wonderful work he has done in his neighborhood, including, but not limited to, keeping neighborhood residents informed about PAC 3 and city activities, promoting education, awareness, and reporting of suspicious activity, monitoring American Tobacco Trail to ensure a safer experience for visitors. Congratulations, Mr. Clark, on being the January Neighbor Spotlight for the city of Durham. And thank you for all the work you do to improve our Durham community. Come up, and so we can get a picture. Is there a photographer here? Oh, you are the photographer. Okay, come on. You need to be. This is. Now, are there announcements by my colleagues on the City Council? Mr. Shule, Mr. Moffitt.
Thank you, Madam Mayor Pro Tem. I do have one announcement. I wanted to make our residents of Durham aware of a new program for Durham renters who aspire to become homeowners. This is a program that has recently been announced, and it's called Neighborhood Lift. And what the program does, it provides down payment assistance of up to $7,500 to eligible applicants. And eligibility includes a couple of things. One is people must be at or below 80% of the area median income. And there is a partial matching requirement, and homeownership counseling is also required. There's about $4 million in this Neighborhood Lift funding that's available in Wake and Durham counties, and this was just announced recently. The mayor was actually part of that announcement at a press conference. And we need to be encouraging Durham residents to apply. The first announcement already created over 500 people who've been interested. Of course, not everyone who applies will be eligible, but it's really important that we have Durham people who are applying for these funds so that we can make sure that some of this money does come to Durham and not just to Wake. There's a website that if you are watching today, you can go to, and it's DHIC. It stands for Downtown Housing Investment Corporation, but it's DHIC.org. And I encourage any Durham renter who is interested in being a homeowner and feels like that they are eligible to go to that website. And I've already spoken to Beverly, and we hope that the city and the county will be using our resources to push this message out as well. So that's all, Madam Mayor Pro Tem. Thank you.
Is this through a bank, or what is the entity?
The money comes from a settlement with a bank, and it's going through NeighborWorks, which is a national organization, and then locally it's going through DHIC.
Okay, good.
Thank you.
Yes, thank you, Madam Mayor Pro Tem. I just wanted to note that on Saturday, I was invited to a meeting of people in the community, along with, I know in attendance was our colleague Steve Shule, as well as County Commissioners Heidi Carter, thank you, I just blanked out, and Wendy Jacobs. And there were 28 people there. They were, it was one of the most diverse groups I've been in, people from all over Durham, various ethnic backgrounds, various ages, young, old, my age, genders across the board. Everybody was focused on the issue of the rising rate of violent crime in Durham, but they were particularly focused on finding solutions. And it was organized by a woman named Robin Cooper. And I just wanted to give a shout out to Ms. Cooper, to the people who spent Saturday afternoon in this meeting, and to people like them who are working on solutions here in the city of Durham. They were there because they were concerned about their neighborhood, their community, and their children. Thank you.
Priority items by the city manager.
Thank you, Madam Mayor, Pro Tem, members of council. Good evening, everyone. No priority items.
Thank you, sir. Mr. City Attorney.
Thank you, Madam Mayor, Pro Tem. No priority items.
And Madam City Clerk.
No items.
At this time, I will go through the consent agenda. These items have been discussed and represent pretty much a consensus of the council. But if there's an item that someone would like to pull, you can feel free to do that. And the consent agenda is as follows. Item 2, Firefighters Relief Fund Board of Trustees appointment. Item 3, Home Written Agreement Community Partners Loan Pool between the City of Durham and North Carolina Housing Finance Agency. Item 4, interlocal agreement with the North Carolina Department of Transportation and the City of Raleigh for the NC-98 Carter Study. Item 5, amendment number 1 to Central Park Waterline Replacement Project. Item 6, professional engineering services for phase 2, sanitary sewer flow monitoring and infiltration reduction evaluation. Item 7, selection of systems integrator for the now North and South Durham Water Reclamation Facilities Process Improvements Project. Item 8, amendment to professional services contract with Alert and Associates Network and Division Inc. for security improvements implementation at priority sites. Item 9, sewer only extension agreement to serve 8405 NC Highway 751. Item 10, Ravenstone and Stone Hill Estates paving 2017 ST-278 contract award. Item 11, Managed Network Security and Services service contract. Items 12 through 15 are items that can be found on the general business agenda public hearings. I will honor a motion to accept the consent agenda as outlined. Are there cards for these? Okay.
Second.
Madam Clerk, will you open the vote? Close the vote. Thank you.
It passes 6-0.
Thank you. Item 12 is as follows. Zoning map change 108 Celeste Circle 2. Is there a staff report from the administration? Thank you, sir.
Good evening, I'm Kyle Tay with the Planning Department, and I can affirm that all legal notices have been executed in accordance with local and state law, and affidavits as such are on file in the Planning Department. Zoning case Z160006, 108 Celeste Circle 2, is a zoning map change request for 0.46 acres. The subject site is presently zoned residential suburban 20 with a future land use designation, a design district, and is located within the compact neighborhood tier. The applicant proposes a zoning designation of planned office of office and institutional with the development plan. The development plan associated with this request graphically commits to the following: general location of access points, location of parking envelope, size and location of building, of the size and location of project boundary buffers. Text commitments have been proffered. A complete list of these text commitments can be found in the staff report or on the cover page of the development plan. A few of the proffered commitments will require that the driveway access to the property will be limited to the southeastern corner of the site. The proposed use will be a surface parking lot. Stormwater runoff will be controlled up to the 100-year storm event. 25 additional 35-inch tall evergreen shrubs beyond what is required by the LDO will be planted. Planning Commission recommended approval by a vote of 11-0 on November 1st, 2016. Staff determines that this request meets the UDO standards for transit-supported development at build-out. While this request is not consistent with the future land use map of the comprehensive plan, it is consistent with the spirit and intent of the comprehensive plan, which provides an ultimate future vision for this area. However, unlike the comprehensive plan, the UDO recognizes that the need for interim development to occur in the compact neighborhoods by allowing zoning districts such as OI to be utilized until such a time that the compact design zoning district can be implemented. Staff has determined that this request is compliant because, one, the application was submitted prior to the adoption of the staff-initiated comprehensive plan updates regarding compact neighborhood tiers and design districts land use standards. Two, the UDO parking regulation regulates that will apply to this committed parking lot develop are governed by the tier and are the same regardless of the zoning district. Three, the OI zoning is an allowable zoning in the compact neighborhood tier per UDO section 4.1.1A. And four, the proposed office use is permitted in the compact neighborhood tier district. Thank you, and staff is available for any questions.
Thank you. I have one person who has signed up, and that's Dan Jewell, a proponent. Dan, you have 3 minutes. I hope I opened the public hearing.
Thank you, and good evening, Mayor Pro Tem and members of the council. I am Dan Jewell of Coulter Jewell Timms, landscape architecture and civil engineering firm here in Durham. We've been asked by the partners of Central Dermatology to help us with this application and say a few words here tonight. We are here with a substantially different proposal than what you saw 2 years ago. Central Dermatology is the applicant rather than previously it was University of North Carolina. They are simply looking for more parking for their business, not for the center in general. You may or may not know, they were actually the first medical facility to locate down at that corner almost 20 years ago now. They had no parking problems at that time, but since then UNC has moved many more medical facilities into that area, creating a parking problem for the neighborhood, even to the point where sometimes Central Dermatology's patients can't find a parking place because other folks are parking in their parking lot. We met with the neighbors earlier last year. We heard what they didn't like about the previous proposal, and we made all those changes to the plan. Kyle went over a few of those, but specifically, the previous plan actually had a driveway off of Celeste Circle. Because Central Dermatology controls the property next to it, their entrance will actually be from the neighboring property, so there'll be no impact to Celeste Circle. The previous application was requesting a stream buffer variance to impact a stream buffer. We are no longer requesting that. We are committing to saving trees and buffers where the previous application did not, and we are also committing to providing a security gate so that when the last person with Central Dermatology leaves at night, they will close up that parking lot so that any concern about folks who don't need to be in that parking lot hanging out there will be alleviated. And of course, the big concern that folks in that neighborhood have out there is stormwater runoff. They've had issues for years and years. So we are committing to managing the stormwater to a 100-year storm, which is kind of unprecedented for most projects that I am aware of. So for these and other reasons, we would ask your approval of this application tonight, following in the steps of the Planning Commission, which gave us a unanimous 11-0 recommendation for approval, along with some very fine comments. I also want to point out that the day or two prior to the Planning Commission meeting, I actually received an email from Chris Selby, who is actually listed as the last president of the Eastwood Lake Neighborhood Association over there, and Mr. Selby said, Dan, your clients have done a good job of listening to the neighbors, so we don't have an issue now with the project as you've proposed it. I'm happy to answer any questions you might have.
Thank you. Are there any other persons who'd like to speak on this item? If not, I will close the public hearing, and the matter is before my colleagues. Steve?
Thank you, Madam Mayor Pro Tem. I just wanted to, I voted against this 2 years ago, and this is a small neighborhood that's under a lot of development pressure, and I really appreciate the efforts that you all have made with this proposal. It's much better, and I'm looking forward to voting for it, and we'll, in fact, if you would like, Madam Mayor Pro Tem, I will move that we approve this.
That's good. Could I get a second? Madam Clerk, we have a motion and second. Would you open the vote? Close the vote.
It passes 6-0.
I need a motion for the consistency statement, please.
Second.
Madam Clerk, would you open the vote? Close the vote.
It passes 6-0.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Now we will move to item 13, street closing of Nevada Avenue, Chester Springs Road, and Hickman Avenue.
Good evening again. Kyle Taylor with the Planning Department. Okay. Anna Bressy proposes to close 1,505 linear feet of public right-of-way. The request comprises of portions of Nevada Avenue, Chester Springs Road, and Hickman Avenue. The right-of-ways are currently dedicated and unopened, and the portions of the streets requested for closure are bordered by property owned by Wallace Design Construction, Big Frankfurt NC, and Triangle Residential Options for Substance Abuse, Inc. If the request is approved, the portions of these right-of-ways will be recombined with the adjacent property owners. The area is owned by B. Wallace Design Construction, LLC, is being recombined with this request and is currently vacant. However, the applicant intends to construct a 14-lot single-family subdivision in this area. That attachment is in the staff report. There are currently no outstanding issues regarding this request, and staff recommends that council approve the permanent closure of 1,505 linear feet of these streets. Thank you.
Thank you. I will open the public hearing, and I have there are five people who have signed up to speak, one proponent and four in opposition. Jared Eatons, you have 3 minutes.
Yes, ma'am, thank you. Jared Eatons with Eatons Land. I'm representing my client. It's B. Wallace Constructions. He's a small local builder that we all know in the community. I'm gonna make a couple of key points because I want to focus on what's being considered tonight, which is a street closing. And I'm not really going to talk too much about a subdivision design unless I'm asked to, because tonight we're here to consider a street closing. The streets that we're talking about closing all run along existing jurisdictional streams. It makes a lot of sense to not build streets across these streams and to close them and do something different. I think that's a fairly common sense approach to what we're trying to do here. The new houses that we're talking about, I'm just touch on it briefly. There is a 14-lot subdivision in for review. That's true. I think it's a good thing that 14 new homes will come to downtown without the need to tear down any other homes to make those homes happen. These are similar products to what was built at Southside that the city basically incentivized redevelopment of. Those homes have done very well. There's no issues with our plan that I can see. Again, it's a great product. It's to me, a simple street closing. I'd be glad to answer any questions you may have. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. I have signed up Mr. Atwood, Ian Atwood, Andy Slaughter, Ann Duncan, and Elizabeth Shera, if you would line up in that order. Yes, sir.
And I didn't say that if everyone gets 3 minutes, I would appreciate a chance to respond with remaining time if necessary.
Okay.
Thank you.
Cool. Good evening.
Good evening. Thank you all for having me. My name is Ian Atwood, and I am here to speak to you all, to ask you all to please delay voting on this.
Could you share your address with the public?
Sorry. I live at 1925 Ward Street, which is around the corner from this proposed development and street closing. And I am asking for you all to delay for a number of reasons. One, for the lack of notice to the neighborhood. There was only one neighbor that I know of that was notified of this activity, despite the fact that the neighborhood association has been in contact with this developer for at least the last 2 years. There was a similar development that is actually adjacent to this property that some similar issues came up, and we have been in contact with them regularly since then, asking to be updated. And just in a communication less than 2 weeks ago, we received no notification that this other additional development had been planned. We also asked for a delay so that neighbors can voice their concern. I know that many folks, I know there's four people signed up to talk tonight, but there were several others who voiced their concerns that they were not able to come tonight and voice those concerns. And we also ask that we have time that the neighborhood can work with the developer on issues of walkability and connectivity, and also establishing some sort of public space in that area, and to deal with issues of stormwater runoff.
Thank you, sir.
That's all I have.
Good evening, council members. My name is Andy Slaughter. I live at 1712 Chester Springs Road, and I'm here to ask you to please delay the street closures. To my knowledge, as Ian said, the neighbors did not receive notice of this hearing tonight for the approval of the closures. Current neighbors who live in this area are already experiencing issues with runoff drainage on their properties. And also several neighbors on the streets of Huron, Wawa, Ward, and Chester Springs have voiced concerns about the additional traffic and stream protection issues by the closures and this development. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Ms. Duncan.
Good evening. My name is Ann Duncan. I live at 2514 Nation Avenue. I'm also here to request a delay in this decision. This is the first step in a 14-home development by B. Wallace. The land is at the heart of Tuscaloosa Lakewood, a neighborhood that doesn't have a central community spot or park. And it impacts our quality of life for reasons that I detailed in an email to you earlier today. B. Wallace has proposed in the development plan for a children's park for these homes, these 14 homes, but the park would be controlled by the HOA, and so access to the larger community could be restricted. So we're requesting more time to work with the developer, Parks and Rec, other possible partners to find a central spot, community place for us to gather as a community. Thank you.
Thank you. And Ms. Shearer.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Elizabeth Shearer. I live on 1714 Chester Springs Road. Several reasons that I'm asking for a delay, as I think the previous speakers have spoken to. There's been insufficient time for the neighbors, the neighborhood, to really talk about what impact this new construction. This is the second version. I think this came before you maybe 2 years ago. We asked at that time for Wallace to stay in contact with us. We asked to be kept abreast of any developments. They have failed to do that. So we were unaware until I received a certified letter a week ago that I went and picked up. So insufficient time. We had asked as a neighborhood to be informed about the original construction of, I think it was 8 homes. Now it's 22 homes, the 8 plus the 14. And so we need that time to look at the impact for us as a neighborhood that is indeed close to downtown, but is getting increasing pressure in terms of the existing houses. One speaker alluded to, and I'm one of those properties, that has had significant water runoff and has had to spend a great deal of money to deal with that water. I'm right by the stream. And so there are a lot of slopes in that land. And I see no reason why some of the proposed sites won't have the same issues that we're having on Chester Springs Road. So thank you for your consideration of this request.
Thank you. Thank you. Are there others who would like to speak in opposition? Mr. Edens, did you want to respond? I'll give you 3 minutes. Sure.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you. I appreciate our neighbors coming out, and I recognize some of the faces. As far as notification goes, I mean, the city makes the notification for street closings. So if someone wasn't contacted, then maybe we should check the city mailing list or something like that, but that's not anything I can address with you. As far as, again, we're talking about a site plan that's not under review, but I would have to guess in the city of Durham, because site plans don't involve neighborhood meetings, most likely, because when you have proper zoning, you just go do your job. I would imagine there's 200 site plans in a city cycle process right now, and not a single one of them probably notified their neighbors because it's by right to do what we're proposing to do for our site plan. So I'll talk about the street closing because that's what I'm here to talk about. The public space, I understand there's a need for public space all over town. I've got 4 kids, 4 and 50, it's the same, right, whether you got 4 kids or 50 kids, but all kids need a place to stay and a place to play. I don't think it's the responsibility of B. Wallace to take a small property and say, I'll tell you what we're going to do. We're just going to cut out 2 or 3 lots here of property we bought and just dedicate public land and maintain it for all the world to use. I don't think that's what we're trying to get at here. I think that if our neighbors would identify a parcel in the Lakewood area, and I'm putting this on record, that you would like to see a sketch on a park, my staff will gladly do it for free, because that's the appropriate way to get a park in downtown. You don't try to force a developer to build it for you. So if we can find some property downtown, I would love to assist free of charge. Regarding stormwater, I think it's pretty safe to say that if we dig up, these roads are platted. They're roads of record. They're platted roads. We're not removing streets. Like, understand, we're not removing roads that people have been using for years and years. We're removing paper streets that are just on a map. They don't exist. They happen to fall right along a bunch of streams. It's in the Jordan Basin. I don't have to have a Diener permit to build that road. I just have to go through the city's process and fill out what's called a no practical alternatives form. Well, when I give my reasoning for having to build those roads on the streams, I hope it won't be because my street closing was denied. Because the next step would be have to build the roads that are there. We're proposing a plan that is very much more environmentally friendly and removes platted rights away that I know for a fact the city probably doesn't want on record because they have streams running down the middle of the right-of-way. So I'm asking tonight that we close these streets like we should, and then we will gladly work with our neighbors on park and other concerns, but I'd like to focus on the street closing if possible. Thank you.
Thank you. Is there anyone else who wants to be heard? If not, yeah. Did you already, you did not speak before. Yes, you may, but I need you to get a sign-up card before you leave, please, sir. Are you a proponent or opponent?
I live on Ward Street.
Are you an opponent?
My house backs up to the area where the houses will be built.
Could you give me your name and address?
Bill Graham.
And your
1923
address?
Ward Street.
Thank you, sir.
My concern is, as the other neighbors said, we have not been informed of what has been going on. I'm also concerned I've looked at other houses that Wallace has built. They do not conform to our neighborhood. In my opinion, they're hideous looking. They look like Easter eggs. They're purple, they're yellow, They're green. They don't conform with our neighborhood. First, there were eight in the small area behind us. Now there are 14 crammed into this area. This worries me greatly in our neighborhood. Not only the blending of the houses to the neighborhood, but the large number of people coming into the area, which we would welcome if it was a smaller number. And the lack of information that we have been given, which all of the neighbors have told you. Okay. So that is my concern also.
Okay.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Could the staff person address the notification piece, please?
So the notification requirement for street closings actually comes from the general statutes, not for the UDO. And the general statutes require that all properties adjacent to the actual street closing, so those immediately facing or abutting on that street, receive first-class certified mail. Additionally, we did post signs for this property, a total of 6, 2 for each street closing. And those are posted on December 15th. The general statutes actually only requires that we do it within 10 days before, but it was posted on December 15th.
Okay. So who among you received notification? Okay, so and that's because you're within the limit just outlined, I suppose. Okay. Well, that's okay. I just needed clarity from staff. I'm going to close the public hearing. I think we've heard from everyone who signed up and someone who didn't, and the matter's now back before the council. Mr. Moffitt, Mr. Shule.
Yes, I'm going to start with a basic question for staff. I know that the UDO encourages connectivity, and so my question was, when I was looking at the street closings, I was wondering why it's not, and the length of the cul-de-sac that would be left there, and I'm thinking about city trucks getting up and down there and providing services. So my question is why not a connection to Chester Springs Road, and from there to Ward?
Sarah Young with the Planning Department. I'll answer briefly, and then I'm going to turn it over to my colleague in the Transportation Department. But the findings for street closings are different than meeting all the ordinance standards to do a subdivision. Mr. Eadings was correct that this is a separate application than the subdivision, and therefore we're not necessarily looking at the same things for this application that we would be. They would be required to meet all applicable standards for the subdivision. But I'm going to defer to my colleague in transportation to talk in detail about that.
Bill Judge with Transportation. I think one of your questions, I guess, was the maximum length cul-de-sac. The UDO does allow up to 800 feet, and in this case it would be measured from, what is that, Huron Street, I believe, where Nevada intersects. So that 800 foot would be measured from there. So far as street connectivity and the connection, Mr. Edens could probably provide better information about the existing environmental features at the end of Chester Springs, but it's my understanding, yeah, that there is a stream buffer there that they're trying to avoid impacting. Other than that, our department generally, well, not generally, but does support connectivity and tries to encourage it for all the various reasons of service delivery as well as just interaction between neighbors.
Ms. Young, I have a question. You said, if I understood what you said that the requirements for street closings are different than the requirements for subdivision approval. Do I read between the lines there that there's a possibility that the subdivision layout that's contemplated in the street closing request would not be approved?
Potentially. I haven't reviewed the subdivision request itself, so I can't attest to that. But hypothetically, someone could close a street with the intent to plat a subdivision that may or may not meet requirements. I will say that the requirements for the street closing are on page 2 of your staff report, and it's basically two things: that the closing of the street or alley is not contrary to the public interest, and the second is that no individual property owner in the vicinity of the street would be deprived of reasonable means of ingress or egress. And those are the only two criteria for street closings.
Is it possible that the result of this street closing would be a subdivision that the planning department would not normally recommend or not? I mean, if someone came in with a rezoning request and they had this kind of cul-de-sac on it, would the department work towards more connectivity?
So typically, there are multiple aspects of development that are regulated in the ordinance, and sometimes we have to balance them. In this particular site, there's some environmental features, so one thing that we try to do is minimize the amount of times that streams are crossed, for instance. So this is a good example of a time where we would have to balance environmental concerns with connectivity. Platting 14 lots on a single point is really, compared to much, much larger subdivisions, not an issue for the planning department.
Okay, thank you. I have a question for Mr. Eden. Mr. Eden, staff has said that there is reason to not connect to Chester, that they think that you have reason not to connect to Chester Spring because of environmental issues. Can you say whether or not that was accurate and illustrate how that is accurate, if it is?
I mean, there are jurisdictional streams associated with where the existing rights of way are. And again, I need to state it again. The subdivision plan, in my opinion, should not have been in the staff report because it's not under consideration tonight. It's a preliminary plan that's currently in review that has no approval. So in my opinion, that's not part of what we're considering tonight. We're considering a street closing. We're closing streets to try to avoid some environmental issues. If a project follows it, which obviously we're here to develop a project, that's fine, but we're really not here, to me, to consider the design of a 14-lot subdivision that is designed per code, that if staff reviews it and approves it, by law has to be approved because it meets the code. But the street closings, to your question, Don, I believe that there are environmental features that we can avoid by not building streets in the existing rights of way.
Okay. I'll just say that I'm actually considering whether or not the street closing will eliminate a point of connectivity that might be important in my opinion. Thank you.
You finished, sir?
Yes,
Mr. Shule, and then Mr. Davis.
Thank you, Madam Mayor Pro Tem. So just for the neighbors, I hope this is clear, but in case it isn't, I'll do my best to explain it, and other council members can chip in. So the property under consideration is being developed by right. In other words, it won't come back to us for any kind of rezoning consideration. So if the sometimes you hear about or read about the decisions the council will make about property and whether or not it can be rezoned, this is not one of those situations. The property will have a site plan and it will still have to undergo rigorous administrative review from our planning department to decide if it meets all of the requirements that we have having to do with stormwater and everything else. And so those are not things that we will be deciding. So it is true, as Mr. Eden said, that this is really a consideration of whether or not it's a good idea to close these roads or these rights of way. And a couple more comments. I want to say, first of all, Mr. Graham appreciated your comments, but I do want to say that In my experience, and I have seen a lot of the homes that the Wallace Company has built, they build a lot of really good homes that are in very high demand. I think about Southside. I think about the area north of Gear Street where they have built a very nice, very popular, in-demand neighborhood. And so I think that in terms of the builder and its responsiveness to the neighborhood and its ability to build good houses and commitment to do that, I feel good about that. I understand, however, that the neighbors feel like they haven't had enough notice, that it is that they have concerns that they would like to talk about with the developer. So my recommendation would be that we delay the vote on this for a month, come back at a date certain that we would set, that it would come back here and give the developer and the neighbors time to talk. But I personally would anticipate at that point that I would be supportive of the closing of the streets, barring something else that I have not found out about that I would find out about then. Because I do think that from what I can tell and what I know about this area, that it makes sense to do so. But I also think that I understand that the neighbors want to have some time to discuss this and don't feel like they have. And so my recommendation would be that we would delay this vote for a month and have the developer and give the neighborhood a chance to talk to the developer about what's anticipated. Thank you, Madam Mayor Pro Tem.
Thank you, Madam Mayor Pro Tem. I guess my initial questions were answered by Ms. Young when she talked about the requirements that she put forth. I guess the question that I would have for Mr. Eden after Mr. Shule's comments has to do with what is your timeline in terms of the development, or your client's timeline in terms of development, and would Mr. Shule's recommendation pose a hardship for your client?
I appreciate the question. And before I start, one thing we haven't talked about, the development tracker that the city has developed online, the website, it's a development tracker website. It's very good. It has current applications. I'm doing an advertisement for the city here, so I'll send a bill. But there's a development tracker online that you can look and see projects that have been submitted that are active, and I think staff does a good job of keeping that up to date. That's my public service announcement. To answer your question, sir, we're in a housing market where you can't build homes fast enough, and we're also in a development community where projects take a long time to get done because everyone's so busy. Out of respect for Mr. Shule, if he wants another 30 days for us to talk about it, then that's what we're going to do. I do feel that when I come back, if I'm asked to provide public park space for Lakewood, my answer will be no. And I do feel if I come back, we may not be able to come to an agreement on some of the issues that are going to be brought up. But if we need 30 days to have another meeting and we'll go in with open minds, then that's fine. But I don't know where we'll end up in 30 days. But I do know that a lot of people want to buy down here, and it would be good for the city to have more population in this area, just in my opinion. Thank you.
Yeah, I think it is important that we sort of dissect the closing from the development.
Madam Pro Tem.
Yes, sir.
Could I follow up and ask for those opponents who talked about time, is there anything that other than not having been informed, is there anything that would happen between now and the next 30 days that would change your mind about the project and cause you to move from being an opponent to a proponent?
I'll ask Ms. Shearer, who will come, since you're the person who received the notice.
Thank you for the opportunity. I think understanding the environmental issues is very critical for us. We are surrounded, and there are a lot of streams And so trying to understand that. And then this whole issue that Mr. Moffitt brought up is around the connectivity. It seems, I'm looking at it and it seems very fragmented and there are lots of, there are different pieces. And I'm not sure I even understand the 14 plus the 8. So that's on me, I understand that, but as a neighbor, as someone who lives there, if I can understand, oh, okay, so this is how it will work, and you've addressed the stream and you know, the issues around our environment being preserved, because you don't want to construct and build and then have your existing residents who've lived here in this neighborhood compromised and their quality of living hurt because you're expanding. We recognize that Durham is expanding and that's exciting, but you don't want to hurt the current residents. So environment and then the whole issue of connectivity. I don't think I understood some of the staff response in terms of balancing environmental versus connectivity. So those would be some things that would help. I think our understanding and support of this project. And I think I understand what is being said, that it's the street closing is separate from the development, mm-hmm. but no, it's not. Because it's for us, it's where we live, and it's leading to the development. So we wanted to come and talk about the sort of the logic of street design is the prelude to this development and the impact it will have on our homes and our lives. Thank you.
Mr. Moffitt, again.
Yeah, I have a question. Well, first of all, people keep talking about 8 plus 14. Is there any idea what the 8?
I'm going to defer to my staff that knows more details than I do.
No, I appreciate that.
So I believe the 8 lots that she's referring to is, if you look at Hickman Avenue on the context map and you look directly across from it, you see another right-of-way there that used to connect through. That area is now being cul-de-sacked and 8 lots are being developed over in that area. I believe that's the 8 that she's
referring to. That's on another piece of property.
Yes.
Right, okay, thank you. So when I look at the, oh wait, but don't go away yet. So I have a question. When I look at the plats currently, it looks like there are 27 lots platted in this area now. Currently platted. Are those all by right? In other words, can they build on all 27 of those lots by right? So they would have to, of course, deal with the stormwater issues related to the streets and so forth, but currently the same area that they're planning 14 homes for is currently platted for 27, is that right?
Correct. Those are platted lots of record. They do have the right to be developed.
Right, okay. Thank you very much.
Mr. Shule, did you have your hand raised? Okay.
Madam Mayor Pro Tem, I will move that we delay consideration of this until the meeting of February 20th.
Okay. Is there a second?
Second.
It's been moved and properly seconded. Madam Clerk, will you open the vote? Is there a discussion on the motion? I will support it only because I think it's important that Mr. Edings get together with them. And I know you don't have to do that, but just in the sense of cooperation, if you would do that, we would certainly appreciate it. You love Durham, so thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Madam Clerk, would you open the vote? Close the vote.
It passes 5-1 with Councilmember Moffitt voting no.
Thank you. The next item is Whitted School, James A. Whitted School Landmark Designation. Are there any? Let's see.
Good evening.
Good evening.
Carla Rosenberg, Planning Department. So this case is J.A. Whitted School Landmark Designation, LD 160001. The applicant is Belk Architecture, represented by Andy Scholl. And the request is to designate the structure and the associated 4.1 acres of land as a landmark. It's located at 200 East Umstead Street on the southeast quadrant of East Umstead with South Roxborough Street. Staff recommends approval, and the Historic Preservation Commission recommended approval of the structure with the land on a vote of 3-2 on their at their August 2nd, 2016 meeting. And those two dissenting votes were to represent to recommend the designation of the land alone. So I'm sorry, the building alone. Pardon me.
The building alone. Okay.
So if you have any questions, I'd be happy to answer.
Okay, I will open the public hearing, and there are two persons signed up to speak who are proponents, and they are Andy Scholl and Daryl Jones. Would you come before us in that order if you're here? Oh, okay. Okay. All right, I certainly support this designation, this the building and the grounds, and that I was in school in the building and on the grounds too. So I'm sort of historic myself, I guess. Okay, I will entertain a motion. I'll close the public hearing. Oh, I'm sorry. You have a, yeah. Okay. Yeah, I was gonna, okay.
Hey, thank you. I just wondered if you could speak a little bit about the decision to designate just the building or the building and the grounds, and how you came to the decision to do the building and the grounds, to request the building and the grounds.
Would that be more of a developer question from a from an architectural standpoint? The land associated with this school is historic in much the same way that the building is, because mid-century schools have a very distinctive style of land with open lawns, very minimal landscaping, and the idea was to have that land and that architectural features beyond that land protected, so to prevent trees from being built up to obscure the architectural features.
Sir, could you share your name and address again?
Yeah, my name is Andy Scholl, with Belk Architecture. Address is 1508 Glendale Avenue here in Durham.
Okay. Thank you. So the historic designation on the land would prevent that land from being developed in any way?
Exactly. And in addition to that, it would also protect the sight lines to the building.
Thank you so much.
Don.
Yes.
And Mr. Shule.
Question was raised previously about the in this, and I wanted to check. At that time, I believe the information I got that we received was that the actual value of the property is not very high. The tax impacts of giving a historic designation are not very significant. Would you confirm or deny that? As it were.
Carla Rosenberg, Planning Department. So if you look at the section of the report that describes the fiscal impact, this property contains three tax parcels. One of those is for the land, which is negligible. The other two are for the residential and commercial parcels, and those are where the value lie. So where in most parcels, they're divided into structure and land, this one has a different tax layout, so the land actually doesn't hold the value. And so as staff, we recommended approval of both the land and the structure, because the it provides the greatest benefit to the city for the least cost.
Thank you. Mm-hmm. I just want to say that I'm delighted with the work that's being done, that's been completed there. There's no question that this is a historic structure here in the city that has great meaning in our community. So I support this application.
Mr. Shule. Thank you, Madam Mayor Pro Tem.
I just want to second, first of all, what Don said. It's this, if there was ever a building that was had tremendous historic value, this is clearly it, and this is an obvious choice for a designation, and I'm fully supportive and am appreciative of the work that's been done, and it's exciting, and I understand you have a CO, is that correct? Partial CO?
Yes, temporary COs were achieved in December.
That's great. Congratulations. I do have a question about the valuation section of this, Carla, and thank you for your work on this. I assume the $1.5 million valuation is prior to the current renovation, and that the value will be considerably more.
So that is prior, that is 2016, those numbers we got in September. And so assumedly the next time it was evaluated, that number may go up. But I can't say specifically.
Right, so let me then ask the developer. I anticipate that the value of this land will be, the property will be significantly more than $1.5 million upon completion. Do you want to give me a range of estimates?
Yes, Daryl Jones, Integral Group, 191 Peachtree Street, Atlanta, Georgia, and the answer is yes. Should be definitely much higher than that.
Definitely much higher. So I just asked that because that means that the fiscal impact eventually will be much higher as well. This is the fiscal impact that's indicated here is based on a very low valuation, and you all are doing a tremendous. How much would you? Can you give me an estimate of the size of the project?
Total for it's roughly a little over $20 million.
Right. So, this is the fiscal impact is actually going to be a lot higher than what's listed here in two ways. One is that we will be receiving much more tax revenue than is indicated here, but at the same time, the value of the tax break will also be much higher than what's indicated here. So I just wanted to make that clear. I'm still planning to vote for it. That doesn't change that, but I do think that the actual the valuation and the fiscal impact is much bigger than what we see here. So I just wanted to clarify that, and I appreciate it. Thank you. Mm-hmm. Thank you, Madam.
Thank you, Madam Pro Tem. I just want to follow up on the comments that we've heard before. I, too, support this designation, not only for the building but the land. I think it's important for us to recognize not only the fiscal issue that Mr. Shule raised, but also about the value of the history of the people who have attended that school or who have had some connection to that school over the years, and the fact that the building was built on a hill and it had a wonderful visual look at the city of Durham. I think that gives even more value to that land. So I think it's important, and I think you would have a lot of people who are in their 80s and 90s and younger who would appreciate the historic value, not only of the building, but also the land. Thank you.
Us who attended Hooded Junior High back in the day, I would certainly vote for it, and I'm a part of that history, Jackie. I'm history myself. And so I will close the public hearing on that note, and I'd like to recognize Carl Webb as a local person who is working on this. Stand up, Carl, and be. Yeah. Sure. I will close the public hearing. The matter is back before us.
I move approval.
Second. There's a motion and a second. Madam Clerk, would you open the vote? Close the vote.
It passes 6-0.
Thank you. Thank you. Give them time to exit and we'll. Now, the next matter before us, the public hearing to receive comments related to our annual action plan. And how many people do I have? Reggie?
Mayor Pro Tem, members of City Council, Reginald Johnson, Director of the Department of Community Development. This is one of two public hearings that we conduct annually on the federal entitlements. I will introduce to you Ms. Wilma Conyers, Federal Programs Coordinator, to outline the particulars.
Good evening, Mayor Pro Tem and members of council. The purpose of this public hearing is to discuss citizen comment on community development needs in Durham neighborhoods as it relates to the use of the receipt of community development block grant funds, known as CDBG, home investment partnership, known as HOME, emergency solutions grant, known as ESG, and housing opportunities for persons with AIDS, known as HOPWA funds. This public hearing is a requirement for the preparation and submission of the city's 2017-18 annual action plan. Notice of this meeting was advertised in the Herald Sun, Carolina Times, and Kapasa newspapers, as well as via general listserv. As a recipient of community development block grant, HOME, ESG, and HOPWA funds, the city is required to hold at least two public hearings prior to its annual action plan. The first meeting must be held early in the development of the plan. We anticipate the second public hearing to be held approximately late April. In addition, the city is required to publish a copy of its draft annual action plan for at least 30 days prior to the submission of the plan. The city's annual action plan must be submitted to HUD by May 15th. The Department of Housing and Urban Development has not yet announced the FY 2017 entitlement allocations. HUD has advised grantees not to submit their consolidated plan and their annual action plan until the final formula allocations have been announced. The city will incorporate contingency language in its draft annual action plan to explain how it will adjust the proposed figures to match the actual final figures once they have been announced by HUD. For planning purposes, the city expects to receive approximately $1.8 million in CDBG funds, $800,000 in home funds, $160,000 in ESG, and $290,000 in HOPWA funds. In closing, a summary of the comments from this public hearing and written comments received from citizens will be incorporated in the final annual action plan. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I will now open the public hearing. We have nine people who've signed up. Do you have more, Diana? And so we have 10. So I will allow 2 minutes per person. And if you would line up as follows: Selena Mack, Katie Huffman, Wilma Dillard, Daniel Sargent, Mark Valletta, Benjamin Filippo, Marilyn Bodison, Vanessa Mason Evans, Becky Winders, and Andrea Stendel, in that order. Good afternoon, good evening.
Good evening. My name is Selena Mack. I'm the Executive Director of Durham Community Land Trustees. That's 1208 West Chapel Hill Street, Durham, North Carolina. I want to start by just saying thank you to this City Council and to the City of Durham for the tremendous amount of support you have shown Durham Community Land Trustees over our 30-year history. Because of your support, DCLT's portfolio is approaching 300 permanently affordable housing units. And specifically tonight, I'm here to ask for your support of DCLT's application for home funding for the renovation of existing affordable rental housing. For some time, DCOT has desired to expand our mission of permanently affordable housing to include Northeast Central Durham. Rather, what we've experienced when housing becomes available is that it's a very competitive process, and they're receiving multiple offers and selling in less than a week at oftentimes well above the asking price. And unfortunately, these sales result in displacement of low-income families. However, in December, DCLT was able to seize an opportunity to purchase 54 units of existing rental housing in Northeast Central Durham in a private sale. 31 of these units is actually in the 10.01 census tract, which is the target area for the mayor's poverty reduction initiative. These units are now in need of extensive renovation to increase the quality of living for the residents who are living there and to increase the energy efficiencies of these units. And this is essentially the crux of DCLT's request for home funds or application for home funds. And again, I want to ask for your support of that application. I want to conclude by emphasizing the urgency of gaining site control of existing affordable rental housing, particularly in Northeast Central Durham. Now, this is a community that's approximately 70% rental housing.
Thank you. If you have comments, would you please give them to the clerk?
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Hi, my name is Katie Huffman, and I work at Senior Pharmacist, 406 Rigsby Avenue. I'm here representing the Durham Home Repair Collaborative. Senior Pharmacist is a nonprofit agency here in Durham that helps seniors understand their medications, and for those who qualify, we actually help pay for some of their medicines. We also do tailored community referrals, and finally, we do Medicare insurance counseling. While our primary focus is not community referrals and resources, we pride ourselves in trying to help our participants access the services they need, because we learned early on that someone cannot focus on their physical health when they're concerned about food or housing insecurities. And often these same stressors end up having a negative impact on their health. As Senior Pharmacists, we try hard to help our participants avoid agency runaround and dead-end referrals, but sometimes the help we need just isn't available. I'm here to share a story of one of our participants, a 75-year-old gentleman named Alan Dillard Sr. He had asthma and COPD, which required him to carry oxygen with him everywhere. In spite of his health troubles, Mr. Dillard tried to be as active as possible and even served as a volunteer on our agency's Participant Advisory Council. In April of 2016, Mr. Dillard let us know that he had mold inside and under his home and that he had recently been hospitalized due to exacerbated pulmonary issues. Between April and October, Mr. Dillard's home condition deteriorated to the point that he had holes in his ceiling and insulation falling down. Throughout this time, we tried to help Mr. Dillard access several housing repair programs, but were told that the necessary repairs weren't offered or that there were long waiting lists for assistance. Mr. Dillard had already done what he could through a reverse mortgage he had taken on his house, trying to make ends meet, and he did not have the money to pay for the repairs himself. Unfortunately, Mr. Dillard passed away in December, but I'm grateful to have his sister Wilma here with us tonight, who will say a few more words about her family's experience.
Thank you.
Good evening.
Good evening.
My name is Wilma Dillard, and I was invited to speak to attend this meeting by the Senior Pharmacy Group. I'm asking for more funding for the Habitat for Humanity and Rebuilding Together of the Triangle on behalf of my brother, my late brother, Alan Dillard Sr., who was a client of the Senior Pharmacy until he passed away on December the 24th, 2016. Alan had COPD and used oxygen machine to help him breathe. We found out in March that there was mold in his home and under his home, not sure how long it had been there. The mold adversely affected his breathing. Many trips to Duke. We were able to eradicate the mold that was inside the house, his daughter and I. But we were not equipped to address the mold under the house. We found someone who agreed to address the mold under the house. We paid him half up front, and we never saw him again. Upon hearing about what happened Allen's mold condition, the senior pharmacy directed Allen to Habitat for Humanity of Durham and Rebuilding Together of the Triangle in March of 2016. Both great entities and resources for seniors. However, Allen died 9 months later after his ability to breathe failed him. It is my desire that more funding be made available for Habitat for Humanity and Rebuilding Together of the Triangle so that seniors and economically challenged taxpaying citizens of Durham can get the help they need in a timely manner. Thank you.
Thank you, Wilma.
Good evening, Council. My name is Dan Sargent. I'm the Executive Director of Rebuilding Together of the Triangle. That story breaks my heart. We have about 85 folks in Durham waiting for assistance, and at this point, our funding at the moment looks like it will only be able to do 10 to 12 homes this year. Obviously, we have a lot of different programs, as was alluded to, and one of the things that we're hoping to do with the Home Repair Collaborative is to help as much as we can deal with coordination issues and try to make sure that our funds are being used as efficiently as possible. I think we've identified coordination issues that we're going to work through, but we also do have scarcity problems. We need more funds to help deal with the issues in Durham. Our organization focuses on providing safe, healthy homes for low-income families around the Triangle. We serve Wake, Orange, Durham, and Chatham. And one of the things that we have observed here in Durham is in some of the neighborhoods, the housing stock is really in deteriorated condition, and so it makes things more expensive to do and just limits the number of homes we can serve. In addition to that, we are excited about the opportunity we have to work with the collaborative group here, and we believe that there are some real opportunities. We've had some success with these types of opportunities in Chatham County and up in Orange County, doing collaborative intake and helping instead of having a homeowner have to sort of navigate through the different programs and the different requirements and the different funding sources and all the things that go into the reason that we have, you know, multiple programs to accommodate these different needs. What we've tried to do in other places is to absorb some of those, some of that navigation and to meet. We actually, in Orange County specifically, we meet monthly with the agencies that do repair. And look at applications and make sure that sometimes we have to split that application up and one agency can do one thing and another agency can do another. But the goal is to make sure that the agencies that are better equipped to manage those processes and understand sort of what the funding requirements are and what the restrictions are able to do that more quickly and not require the homeowners to try to navigate a system that's really opaque. Thank you for your time.
Could I ask a question of clarification? I noticed a Garner, North Carolina address.
That's
where you live.
I'm sorry. No, that's our headquarters. Our Durham warehouse is at 607 Ellis Road.
Oh, I just...
I put the wrong address on my...
Yeah, let the record show.
Thank you.
Okay. All right.
Good evening, Council. Thanks for your time tonight. We have a brief time to speak, so we've given you some flyers with more information, or you will have. My name is Mark Valletta. I'm the Director of Housing and Home Improvement for Resources for Seniors, which is in Raleigh, North Carolina. We are a nonprofit that used to be called Wake County Council on Aging. I don't know if any of you are familiar with it. For 43 of those 45 years, we were strictly a Wake County agency. All services were there. 2 years ago, we took on the Weatherization Assistance Program in Durham County, which does a lot of great things for energy reduction, making homes more comfortable. Power bills reduce usually 20 to 25%. What I have to point out to you is that is not a home repair program. It is strictly an energy program. So when we come to Durham and we find the homes that Dan alluded to in terrible shape, we can't weatherize them. So we've partnered with the collaboration to try to get a network of folks that can make those repairs so that we can come in and provide the weatherization services that we want so badly to provide in Durham. We also have one dilemma is that Durham is an unusual county. This is really the big municipality here, and out in the rest of the county, there's no big cities like Wake County with all these other areas. We run the Raleigh's limited repair program. We do carries. We have a lot of connections in Raleigh under one roof, so we can just say, well, we'll just take that program and fix this, and then we'll go do weatherization. We don't have that in Durham. That's why we've joined this collaborative. I just hope that that we can work together as collaborative and with the city to sort of reduce the duplication of efforts and have some way that we can all get together. And so when a client has a need, we can sort of shuttle them through the process, through all the people, the players that are available, so that we can help as many people as possible. I thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Good evening. Thank you, members of council.
Good evening.
Benjamin Filippo, 2002 East Main Street. I'm the executive director of Preservation Durham, here to speak in support of the Home Repair Collaborative, as you have packets in front of you. Preservation Durham has recognized that there is a major need, as has been suggested, to find ways to retain homeowners in their homes, particularly as it relates to preserving and protecting minority assets and wealth throughout the city and county of Durham. As has been alluded to, there's a great array of repair problems that people face. Even as a preservation organization that is not necessarily the first number of people often call when they need a home repair, we get 1 to 3 calls every single week, typically from elderly homeowners who have many of the same problems that we've heard here tonight. Oftentimes contractors who have left, oftentimes bills that they are faced with that are completely insurmountable and have physical health conditions whereby they can't actually take on the repairs themselves. This year we'll be starting the Preservation Equity Project along with Self-Help Credit Union, which will be a model based on Cleveland, looking at free technical assistance for older homeowners matched with a subsidized interest rate home equity loan. And our hope is that this program, along with the many others you're hearing about and see in front of you tonight, if we are able to streamline and make more efficient the intake process for these numerous programs with the city's help, we strongly believe that we can be more effective. We can reduce the number of waiting lists that we currently have, as you'll hear and continue to hear, are very long for just about every program we have. And we have many people who simply don't know how to navigate to the resources that may be available to them. So again, I ask you to review the documents and support sort of, you know, a long-term strategic funding for home repairs across the city and county. Thank you.
Thank you. Melinda. Good evening.
Good evening. My name is Vanessa Mason Evans. I stay at 3223 Dearborn Drive, Durham, North Carolina, 27704. I am one voice of Bragtown, of a Bragtown community, which I speak for many voices. We have a community that has been unseen and unheard until violence hits our community. But there are people within our community that truly have a concern and want to see our community grow to be a better community and a safe community. Deontay Hart is a young man which was killed on my property, which is at 602 Martin Street, the corner of Martin Street and Dearborn, in which I own the property. We would like to see changes within the community because of the violence that's going on within the community. We feel that it's deemed to be unsafe because of the shootings, not only at my property, but within that area. We have a lot of drive-bys. There have been shootings at the store. And we want to change the environment of the store, not just the store, but the people who live within that community. We have homes that need repairs, and we have sidewalks that have not been finished. These are the needs. We need a playground that can be upgraded because our playground hasn't been upgraded in years. We would like to see improvements not only to the store, but the entire community, not just Bragtown, but the surrounding area of Bragtown. And we would like to be able to network with not just Bragtown, but the entire community of Durham as a whole. So I'm hoping that you will take what I've said into consideration. I thank you for listening to me tonight, and thank you on behalf of the Bragtown community.
Could I have a copy of your remarks?
Yeah, let me take this.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I'll get that.
Good evening.
Hi, good evening.
My name is pronounced Marlinda. Marlinda Bodison, 607 Canal Street, Durham. And I'm here just to piggyback on what Mark and everyone else is saying about the community and the needs for housing repairs. and the tax increases that we all have received this year, my taxes alone more than doubled from one year last year, and now it's more than doubled what it was last year. We have a lot of elderly people in East End community, in the East End community, that really cannot afford to pay double what they were paying last year and having problems paying that. I know a lot of people that are on fixed incomes or disabled, or even have children, that they don't know where the money is going to come from. And a lot of it is going to come from monies that were allocated for one thing. They're now going to have to choose between food, medication, education, even coats and shoes for their children or for themselves or their whoever they're taking care of. If we could get a grant to assist the people with their taxes, it would really help all the homeowners who have experienced doubled or more tax increase in the last year. Also, the homes in East End, they're old, they need repair. Just like the gentleman was saying about the weatherization, they can't do that because of the repairs necessary to actually.
Thank you. Mm-hmm. And I understand what you're talking about, and that's something that we're looking at too. Thank you. Andrea? I am calling the names. Yeah, thank you.
Hello, my name is Andrea Stoidel. I am an AmeriCorps volunteer with Habitat for Humanity, which is that, am I supposed to give my address or the organization's? I'm at 603 North Driver Street. Okay. Habitat is 215 North Church Street. And I'm part of the repairs team at Habitat, and we enact 50 repairs per year to households that are at or below 50% of the area median income. And I know that we receive a ton more applications than we're able to serve. And so just want to add to the chorus of folks saying that we need more of this. I can just speak personally that I've seen over and over again we're about halfway through our year. And over again, when we can do critical home repairs, it really incentivizes those homeowners to also have pride in their homes and to do some, we've had people remodel after they'll repaint their house. They'll just be also a lift in spirit, which seems really important. So thank you.
Thank you for your enthusiasm. Rebecca Winders.
I'm sorry, I was just thinking I was next to the last.
Yeah, you were last.
My name is Becky Winders, and I live at 1304 Seton Road. And I'm a member of the Durham Community Land Trust and the Coalition for Affordable Housing and Transit, but I'm speaking for myself. And I'm kind of saying the same thing that other people have said in a different way, but we need to find a way to do more. Last year, the council wisely commissioned a thorough analysis of housing needs and adopted some sensible goals, and I'm grateful to you for your creative efforts to keep housing affordable. But I just want to emphasize the urgency of following through with or increasing the goals that have been set, especially the goal of preserving affordable rental housing. Based on 2012 data, the city had 15,000 low-income houses, households paying more than 50% of their incomes for housing. And then in addition, we had another 6,100 households who were living in subsidized housing and needed help to meet their housing needs. So that would make a total of 21,000. And currently, we're meeting 30% of the, less than 30% of the need. And the need is understated because of the timing and the I had a more stringent standard of 50% and all. And it also does not account for the homeless. Of the 6,100 subsidized units, 1,240 will reach the end of their period of restricted affordability within the next 5 years, and maybe some of them have already done it by the end of 2016. Because of their age, we can expect that they will require additional subsidies for renovations to keep rents affordable while maintaining quality. So the plan, which is ambitious, called for 1,095.
Thank you. Could we have your comments? Thank you.
I just wanted to give you the materials from the Home Repair Collaborative.
Thank you very much.
Thank you
very much, and thank each of you for, I think that wraps up the persons who've signed up. Thank each of you, first of all, for the work that you're doing, and secondly, for carving out time to come and share with us how you feel our funds should be expended. I am going to close the public hearing. The matter is now before the council. I will entertain a motion to just receive the comments. That's what we need to do.
Okay, I will make that motion. I'd also like to make some comments at the appropriate time, but I will move that we receive those comments.
It's been moved and properly seconded. Madam Clerk, would you open the vote?
No, we get comments.
Well,
we would like to discuss the motion, please.
Just a moment. Let me run this meeting, right or wrong. Mr. Moffitt, make your comment.
Okay, thank you very much. I appreciate it, Madam Mayor Pro Tem. And Mr. Shaw, appreciate if you don't mind me going first. First thing I want to say is there were comments about subsidized housing, and I just wanted, for those people who may be watching at home and maybe some here, just to point out that anybody who's taking a mortgage deduction is living in subsidized housing. I'm not commenting anything about what was said here. The subsidized housing is a broad term, and anybody might be watching at home and takes it in a certain way needs to realize many people are living in what is subsidized housing. It's really important that we use tax dollars to help with housing across the city. As I've listened to the comments tonight, I've been thinking about the mayor's emphasis on parks. And one of the things that he has said over and over again is that we should not be building new parks until we can maintain the parks that we have. We have an ambitious plan to develop more affordable housing throughout the city. And it's and I support the comments tonight in regard to the need to also maintain the affordable housing stock that we already have. And then one other comment I wanted to make was regarding property taxes. I understand the whole the plans that are being worked on in support of that, but there were comments about elderly people having to make choices between taxes and warm clothing, for example. And I just, Marlinda and anyone else that's working with people like that, there are tax abatement programs available through the tax administrator's office with the county. So in fact, they should make sure that people are aware of those programs. That's all I wanted to say. Thank you very much, Madam Mayor Pro Tem.
You're welcome, sir. Mr. Shure.
Thank you, Madam Mayor Pro Tem. I have a couple comments. First of all, I want to also appreciate everybody that came out tonight to speak. We heard some really important things and really appreciate it. Just a couple of comments. Becky, I want to appreciate your emphasis on us doing more, and we have a plan, and it will, I think that we will be doing a lot more, and we will be hearing from our administration about what some of this is going to cost us, and we've already got preliminarily know, but we need to start paying for it, and so want to say that if we're going to do the work that we need to do in Durham on affordable housing, it's going to cost us some more local funds, and we need to be prepared for that. I'm very excited about the land trust purchase of the 54 units. And I think this is a very exciting development. We have been talking a lot. One of our highest priorities is the preservation of naturally occurring affordable units or units that are coming out of mandatory period of affordability as permanently affordable. And this is one of the first times that I have heard that we have had this kind of opportunity. It's exactly the kind of opportunity we're looking for, and I just want to congratulate those who have worked to make this happen and look forward to its success, and am really grateful to you all for leading that. I do have a question for the gentleman from Rebuilding Together Durham. Is he still here? My question is, of the 85 homes that you said were seeking repair, or let me ask it this way, what's your average repair cost for a home in Durham?
We're between typically, well, to do sort of the key health and safety priorities, we're typically between $12,000 and $18,000.
Okay, thank you.
But it varies widely.
Okay, and does the person from Habitat have similar information on those figures? The Habitat repair cost?
She stepped out, but okay. I do know they administer the urgent repair program for the yeah. State Housing Finance Agency. The yeah. cap there is $8,000. I believe
you.
That's their primary source of funding.
Okay. So I guess what I would be interested in from the collaborative is, you know, is there a number that is the number that you all are thinking about? And, it, you know, not tonight, but at some point it would be useful to know that. And we are lucky that Wilmer Conyers, as you all know, has done a great job on this report for many years, and these applications, very big, it's very complicated. She's here listening, but from my standpoint, what would be good and useful is to have some sort of some idea of what the number is that you're interested in. Also, I was really pleased to hear about the Preservation Equity Program. That seems like a real good advance in the way we're thinking about preservation in Durham, and appreciate you working on it. And then finally, I just wanted to comment about the playground in Bragtown. At some point, it would be good to know the location of that program and that playground and who owns it. Our city playgrounds, my understanding is that they're all at this point in pretty good shape. We have a steady program of renovation. So if this is one that I'm not aware of, or that the city is not aware of, and it is city-owned, I'd be very interested in knowing about it, and I'm sure that our administration would as well. So those are my comments, Madam Mayor Pro Tem, and I appreciate you. Thank you.
Sure. And I hope that the collaborative will make sure that you keep our administration in the loop, because they're the ones who are going to be working and bringing these matters back before us. So don't forget proper protocol. Thank you very much. We'll call for a motion to accept the comments if there are no other comments. It's been moved. Can I get a second? It's been moved and properly second that we receive the comments. Madam Clerk, would you open the vote? Close the vote.
It passes 6-0.
Thank each of you for coming to speak on this matter. And before we move to our last item, I will let those who are not interested in that item exit the room. We have one supplemental item tonight, item 17, a proposed city charter amendment to change the process of conducting Durham municipal elections. And the purpose of this public hearing is just to receive comments from the public on this item. Mr. Turney?
Thank you, Madam Mayor, Pro Tem, members of council. On this item, I have provided you with a memo. It reads as a frequently asked questions memo, where I tried to anticipate the questions that would likely come either from council or for members of the public, and also as an opportunity to educate the public as to what this particular public hearing is about, what it's not about, and if there are any questions that anyone has, I'll be happy to do my best to answer those questions. But I do want to reiterate that tonight you're only receiving public comments, and at some point in time you may choose to take some other action on the item. What has happened in the past is that after the public hearing has occurred, no action has been taken, which essentially means that no change would be made to the election process that we have here in the city. But I'm happy to answer any questions that you have.
Well, clearly we have four people who signed up, and we definitely would not be voting on anything with that kind of participation tonight. So we will open the public hearing and call to speak Anita Keith Faust, Jackie Wagstaff, Chris Tiffany, and Jim Svara. And each of you have 2 minutes.
Hi, I'm Anita Keith Faust, 323 West Trinity Avenue, Durham,
North
Carolina. Good evening. I've already sent you an email with my point of view on this issue, and basically I think it's a money issue. Somebody may think they're going to save money. Well, it's been a long struggle for civil rights in America, and we're being forced to go back in time, and this is another issue that I think falls into what has been going on the state level, where people are being disenfranchised under the guise of saving money. Okay, so we know that, you know, Governor McCrory lost the election, probably because of HB2, but also because of his stance on Medicaid. You know, disenfranchised people being further disenfranchised by their publicly elected officials. Also, I think it's important for us to realize that all of this packing and stacking, or whatever they're calling it, from the way that they redistricted, changing the lines, this falls into that type of thinking. And I just want to get you to look at my email, and those who are out there in the television land, I made a request for it to be part of the public record, which it probably would be anyway. Please, if you're interested, you can get a copy from our clerk, Ms. Ann Gray. But we need to really look at who it is that is suggesting that it's better to give people less of a voice. We have to look at each one of you now and see which way you're going. I understand, Mr. Attorney, that there's no voting going to happen. This is just to voice our opinions. But we're going to take a look at this. Please make it known when you're going to vote on it. Thank you.
Thank you, Anita.
Good evening.
Good evening.
This is not the time. This is really not the time to propose changes in the charter of the Durham municipal election. We just went through a tumultuous year, 2016. I don't even think we're over 2016 election. We had shenanigans going on over in Raleigh in the legislature, trying to suppress voters, trying to take away their ability to vote through many means. And we were over there. We know what they're doing. And now we have a suggestion of amending, doing an amendment to the charter, which would allow for one election, which you know that off-year elections yield low voter turnout among the black community. Let's be clear. What happens in this case with this, you have, if nobody gets 50% of the votes at the end of that one election, you have to have a runoff. That runoff will take place at least 4 to 5 weeks after that election. Well, we don't come out the first time. We definitely not gonna come out the second time. And if you are a person of color that's running, who have little means to run, but you may be a good candidate, you're gonna exhaust all of your resources on the first election. You're doing the runoff, you're never gonna win. This board, will look like it has looked a lot of times, not like us. And it's not fair. You're taking away the ability to be able to have a voice. We need to leave it. If you want to do something, look at this ward system that is not a ward system, which is really an at-large system. Think about adding two more members to this council and injecting a true ward system where only people in your ward can vote for you. Not that you have to live in the ward to run for the seat, but everybody in the city. So if I ran for District 1 and all the white people on the other side of town don't like me, then my representation is not going to happen because they're going to outvote these black people. We know this. It's been happening for years. So this is not good. We need to look at some other things.
Thank you, Chuck.
Gentrified Durham is anti-democratic, small d, suppressing local minorities in many ways. Speak out in defense of democracy. Turnout for local elections is usually low, primaries especially, sometimes less than 10%. Local elections are held in off years as one of many tried and true ways to suppress the vote to help incumbents, like at-large voting, a tactic designed to help incumbents to suppress minority votes to minimize the representation of local minorities, like having Woodcroft and Parkview decide who will represent East Durham target areas, or Fayetteville deciding who represents Durham in Congress, or South Carolina voters choosing McCrory. And now you want to eliminate primaries which threaten incumbents, supposedly because it's cheaper. You could save money on elections designed to minimize the representation of local minorities by giving unwanted voters no choice at all. As it is, every single election cycle for decades, local cops, your enforcers, have persistently threatened people engaged in voter registration activities, threatening arrest on some trumped-up charges for trying to get people registered to vote, running off people with voter registration forms, selective voter suppression like the FBI abusing its authority to influence last year's elections, even worse in the power of Russia and the FBI exercising clandestine political influence or law enforcement organizations honestly making political endorsements. They should not abuse their authority by threatening people engaged in important democratic processes. If you all truly want to facilitate, support, and defend democracy, you will oppose all forms of voter suppression, including persistent, blatant threats to democracy by armed enforcers who say their job is not law enforcement but social control, and at-large elections which minimize the representation of local minorities, and odd-year local elections instead hold local elections and primaries at the same time as statewide elections and primaries, even if that means some challenge to incumbency. Durham has spent a large chunk of $1 billion oppressing people. Save money, save democracy.
Thank you, thank you, thank you.
Good evening. Jim Savara, 1114 Woodrun Road. I want to encourage you to wait before making this change for two reasons. First, it may not work in what I think is the intended outcome. And secondly, I hope you will keep looking for a better alternative within the scope of the current election system, and other kinds of proposals have been made as well. Greensboro uses the primary general election system. Raleigh uses the general election runoff. In Durham, our history has been to have 4 to 8% turnout in the primary, 8 to 18% in the general election. The consequence of going to a general election and runoff is that fewer people will make the final decision. The ultimate choice, the winner, will be determined by a smaller turnout in what is a less election that generates less interest. I think the logic of the change is that there will be fewer and less expensive second elections if most elections can be resolved in the general election. It appears from a quick check that only one of the last four elections in Durham would have entailed a runoff. But changing the election rules could very well change the dynamics and make that happen more often. So you would have the second election. And in Durham, given that all voting is at-large members and district members who are elected by all members, any single seat that's not resolved in the general election will require a citywide election for the runoff. So I think it may happen more often than you're suspecting, and it will be just as expensive as the current approach. Will the change reduce turnout overall? I think it's a concern you need to keep in mind. Do not make this change is the second point I would make until you've explored the instant runoff voting alternative. I know it's not permitted now, but I encourage you to fully explore the option of a local bill to make this possible.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. Okay, there are no other persons signed up for this item, so I will close the public hearing.
The Mayor Pro Tem.
And the matter is before, I close the public hearing, then
I'm
the matter
you,
is before you.
I'm asking you not to do that before.
Why? So. I mean, you can still speak now.
Thank you, Madam Mayor Pro Tem. It's my understanding, actually I know, that there is another meeting that's happening this evening that yes. includes a number of individuals who would like to have been heard at this public hearing. Mm-hmm. And I'm wondering if it's possible for us to hold this open until yes. our next yes. council meeting so that yes. we can, as opposed to closing the public hearing.
Okay. Yes,
and maybe our staff can help us figure out if that's something we can do.
If that's Patrick, the will of the council, we can do that.
We can have you another one.
Just wouldn't close the public hearing. You just okay. continue it for okay. the next meeting or okay. whichever meeting you'd like.
Okay. Well, I'll open the public hearing. I will reopen the public hearing, and what's the date, Patrick, that you would?
That's really up to council.
Okay.
Next meetings are the 6th and the 20th.
Yeah.
February 6th.
It's February 6th. That 6-6, that rings a bell about something. I'm not exactly sure what it is. Okay. February 6th? Okay. Jillian.
Thank you, Madam Mayor Pro Tem. I just had a quick comment. I had asked previously when this issue came up about the possibility of using a form of ranked choice voting like instant runoff in our elections, and our city attorney gave me the sad news that it is currently not allowed under state statute. However, there have been in the past short periods of time where the state has allowed municipalities to use ranked choice voting, and that is on our legislative agenda for this year to ask the state to allow us to use that. And I just, in case folks were unsure of what that is, it's a system of voting that allows you to rank your choices in an election rather than just pick one candidate. So you would be able to say, this is my first choice, my second choice, and then there's a process by which the lower vote getters are eliminated and their votes are distributed to those folks' second choices. So it's a much more democratic way of actually determining the result of an election because it prevents the spoiler effect. It prevents people from having to vote strategically for someone who they think can win rather than who their true choices are. And so you get very different outcomes. So that's something that we are continuing to look into. And I want to appreciate everyone for coming out and speaking on this tonight. And I'm glad we're going to have the opportunity to hear from additional folks at our next meeting. The other thing I wanted to check in about was that there's a possibility that the state will be holding elections this year, a primary and a general. And we were told that if we were able to hop onto those elections, that we would not have, that it would be less expensive for us. We wouldn't have to pay for our own elections. So I'm not sure that we want to, that if we move this forward, we might not want to make this decision for this year, regardless, because of the possibility that a state election will happen that would enable us to do it more inexpensively. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. So I guess I need a formal motion to continue the hearing until February 2nd?
6.
Can I have a motion?
I'll make that motion, ma'am.
I'll second that.
It's been moved and properly second that we continue the hearing to February 6th. Madam Clerk, would you open the vote and close the vote?
It passes 6-0.
Thank you. And I have an item that I want to discuss at the meeting on Thursday, and it's a letter that I saw from Congressman Price regarding Medicaid expansion, and I was hoping that we will support that letter, so I'll get copies made for everyone. It was on his Twitter account. If there are no other matters to come before this august body, the meeting is adjourned.